Right. So I would be taking up three snacks. One is staining challenges and how to ensure that you get good staining every time you try to stain. And then issue of triple layers and how to utilize chandelier in a better way so that you can use it more effectively. So as far as staining is concerned, I think we all have been blessed and spoiled by this brilliant blue green. Ever since this has been available, this has become a drug of dye of choice for almost all VR surgeons. We are normally using the Indian brand, but you can use the other one from Dork also. We have no financial interest. Now the technique, I hope the video on the left side is visible. Okay. So if you see the technique which most of us prefer to use is we use a 2 ml syringe and we can attach it either to a soft tip or a 26 gauge needle. And the most important thing which I would like to share with fellows is always test fire it outside before firing it in. And what we try to do in for staining in these cases is do quadrant wise spraying of dye on the macula. And as you can see at the end of this video, you can very nicely see this is a case of resurgery for a persistent macular hole, and you can see the area which has been peeled and the area which has not been peeled. Avoid direct stream going to the foveal area. Of course, you don't want to damage the cells there. And when you are injecting the dye, keep an eye on disc. If you feel that your pressure is getting high or disc is losing pulsation, be careful that probably your stream is going to be very very fast and it can be dangerous. So it should be smooth. Now, the beauty about this BBG dye is that you can restain it, which we were very hesitant with the ICG when we were using. And restaining, actually what it does, it probably stains the undersurface of ILM. So if you are not happy with the stain, you can restain it. But most people would ask us that how much contact time you will allow for your dye. So answer is it is almost instantaneous. So the moment you inject the dye and you take out one instrument and introduce another instrument, that much contact time is good enough for this BBG dye. And as you can see, once I have restained, the flap is so nicely visible in these cases. Now, visualizing the flap even after peeling is important these days because you are using flaps to cover macular holes. So again, this is again a very useful tip to restain. Why do we restain? Because we want to see the flap during fluid air exchange also. And of course, the area which you have already peeled, try to avoid spraying on that area. So you need to be selective on the area where you are going to stain. Now, a lot of my colleagues sometimes would use proportional reflux for staining, but we don't prefer it. The main reason is many times because we are reusing our cutters and reflux can actually contaminate the thing. And overall, the whole process becomes more time consuming. And again, you have to control the injection, dye injection with your foot rather than thumb. So we are much more, I think the time of our thumb to brain time is lesser than our foot to brain. So that's the reason we don't advocate this proportional reflux for staining. Now, another tip I wanted to share with all the fellows and VR surgeons is that many times you don't get a good quality silicone tip. So you can very easily use 26 gauge tip, the 26 gauge needle. And the biggest advantage is it is almost always available. You can use the new one every time. And another advantage is it will not drag the vitreous once you are introducing it into vitreous cavity. And the kind of staining you get, even if it is not reaching the retina, you can't go close to retina, the staining you can get is good enough. So you can see on left side, the staining is by needle, and on the right side, it's by soft tip. It's quite comparable. So this is another tip I wanted to share. And for some of our younger colleagues who have not seen triamcinolone being used, even triamcinolone can also help you visualize ILM. So if you have run out of stock of BBG and suddenly you have to peel ILM, you can use triamcinolone for that also. So this is a very old video. Now, another thing, many times for detached retina, we would stain under PFCL. So, and again, the advantage of this dye is it works very well under PFCL. You can restain also under PFCL. And sometimes what can happen is if there are retinal folds, there can be some pooling. And this pooling can actually, may not allow you to identify the edge. So here, what you can do is you can again aspirate the excess dye, and then you can easily find the edge of the ILM. So this is another small tip. If you are not able to find the edge, maybe you have injected too much of dye under PFO. Now in high myopes, sometimes the contrast is not good, and even when you stain, it looks like that you are not able to see as good as in emmetropic eyes. But here the trick is to start the peeling. You create a small nick at ILM, and the moment you get your flap, the flap is very nicely visible in the background of this white atrophic areas. Another tip I wanted to share is that in high myopic eyes, sometimes there can be paravascular holes. So now, see in this case, I am staining, and the amount of staining I wanted was not good enough. So I'm again staining. And now I'll try to peel under PFO. But again, you can see the flap, but still I am, because of the poor contrast, I'm not able to. And now this, what happens is, the moment I inject dye under PFO, it goes subretinal. You can still peel the ILM, I am getting the contrast, but this is something which you don't like, subretinal dye. I was able to reposition the flap under PFO over the macular hole, but then I had to create another hole, retinotomy superiorly to drain this subretinal dye, because I didn't want to leave dye in submacular space. So these were all small, I think, tricks on staining. Now the second snag which we wanted to discuss was, there are two conditions where we do vitrectomy, and there are actually three layers which we have to remove. One is proliferative diabetic retinopathy. And I think Dr. Saurabh is a very big fan of staining and restaining to find all these three layers. So you see, I have removed the anterior vitreous. Now I have stained, and we could partially stain even this posterior layer of posterior hyoid, the posterior layer of the vitrocerasis cavity. And I'm peeling it, and you can see there is a pre-existing break at the base of neovascular complex. Again, in these ischemic retinas, you have to peel little more carefully, don't be in hurry. And you have to modify your peeling direction also to avoid tears. Now, this is the point which is very important I wanted to share. Restain it, and you will find that ILM is still there. So that's the third layer which we have to take care of, so that you can relieve all the traction at the macula. And this is more important if you see a neovascular complex within vascular arcade. And similar thing happens in high myopes. Now again, if you ask me, high myopes, the anterior vitreous layer, I think most of us will recognize easily, even if in our early vitrectomy days, and ILM can be nicely stained. It's the middle layer which can puzzle us, especially the beginners. So to identify it, I think you have to notice the tenacity and the characteristic of this middle layer. On the left side, you can see I'm removing it with a cutter. On the right side, this is, I think, video from Dr. Reddy. The forceps is being used to peel the middle layer. And in the top video, you can see a finesse loop is being used to get rid of the middle layer. So you will not be able to stain ILM properly, and your staining would be patchy if you are not removing this middle layer. So this, I think, recognizing and removing all three layers in these two conditions is very important. Now another, I think I'll very quickly cover this topic, chandelier. Dr. Ajay has already highlighted. And if you can see the video on the top, that's how you have to fix it at the start of your surgery, so that you can actually get a nice illumination in these surgeries. As you can see here also, I think all of us know that if you have complex diabetic TRDs, you will need bimanual dissection, and you will fix the chandelier. But this is a relatively less known indication, that if you encounter a foveal neovascularization. Now again, to dissect it safely without creating a foveal tear, it's better to fix chandelier. And plan your chandelier in a way that you have to insert it opposite to the site of pathology. And if you insert it proper in proper direction with proper bends, fix it with the tapes, you will get very nice illumination. You can see I'm doing bimanual and illumination is quite good. I think this is another small video where you can see chandelier is being used for bimanual handshake technique. Sometimes you get, I think I'll take another 30 seconds and just finish. So this is very handy, chandelier. Again, your, I think, planning a site for chandelier has to be, in a way that it is illuminating where you are going to dissect. And this is again a very good indication for using chandelier if you are operating and you are planning to do a direct PFO silicon oil exchange. Like in a case like this, I realized that this is a too peripheral giant tear. So I may not be able to do justice during fluid air exchange. So I was planning direct PFO oil exchange. So what you can do is you can just fix, replace your infusion cannula with chandelier. And one of the ports you will inject oil, and from the other port, you will keep aspirating the PFCL, and your soft tip will keep on moving posteriorly as you keep on injecting. So this is all I wanted to share. Thanks for watching.